So to begin with, I'd like you to think about your best friend. In particular, the reasons why they are your best friend. Perhaps they've always been there for you. Perhaps they've kept your deepest and darkest secrets. Perhaps they don't really require much of you. They're a very giving person. What if I told you that you have a best friend that you never knew about? Someone who, like your human best friend, knows and protects your deepest, darkest secrets, is resilient in the face of adversity, and keeps giving. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We are going to talk about how encryption, secret codes, and strong mathematics is the best friend that you never knew about. We are also going to talk about how quantum computing, a mysterious and powerful new force, threatens the protection that your best friend gives you and might endanger your day-to-day security. So the reason why I wanted to give this talk is to answer some foundational questions about internet security. Why is it okay that I send my password out over the internet, for example? What is HTTPS and why is it better than HTTP? So these are the questions that we're going to answer along the way as we go through this talk. So, encryption. What does it mean? It simply means that every piece of information that you give out on the internet is protected through powerful mathematics. Even if someone was in another position on the internet wanting to see what you throw out there every day, your passwords, your cat pictures, your financial transactions, anything, they could not see it because it is protected by strong maths. So that's wonderful. We have this sense of security as we send our data out over the internet. But not only that, encryption tells us who is trustworthy on the internet. So if you've ever seen that little lock icon in your browser, that means that encryption is mathematically verifying the identity of the person that you are talking with. So this is why we would use HTTPS over HTTP, because the S stands for secure, and we know that we are protected when we are browsing and sending our information out onto the internet. And one of the best things about encryption, in my opinion, is that it doesn't take very much anything special for us to use it. We simply browse the internet. We don't have to pay for it. We simply gain this wonderful protection and identity verification essentially for free. It just works. Like a very low maintenance kind of best friend who gives you the best things about friendship without asking for much at all. How does encryption work? So for that, we're going to turn to Alice and Bob. So Alice wants to send a cat picture to Bob. So what she does is she takes her cat picture and she puts that together with a secret key into a cipher, a change machine. So what this change machine does, it essentially scrambles up the cat picture, and then Alice sends it to Bob. So you see Marla there. Marla, again, for some reason, wants to know the content, wants to know what Alice is sending to Bob, but she cannot, because the change that the change machine makes is simply too difficult for her to reverse without that secret key. So when the scrambled data gets to Bob, he simply does the reverse. He puts the scrambled data together with the secret key into the change machine and boom, there's the cat picture. No matter how hard Marla tries without the secret key, she cannot see the cat picture. She cannot see the information transmitted between Alice and Bob. But there's kind of a problem with this image. Alice and Bob have to have the same secret key. But how do they do that? So maybe Alice writes down her secret key, ships it in the physical post, and it gets to Bob and then he gets out and uses it and things like that. But Marla might be able to intercept that as it goes through the physical mail. So that's a problem with this model of encryption. So in order to exchange keys, Alice and Bob, their computers, have to have what I call a number baby. It's a bit strange, but bear with me. What happens is, Alice's computer and Bob's computer each generate two numbers. So one is a public number, one is a private number. So four numbers in total, two numbers each. Through the magic of mathematics, these two numbers kind of go in a dance, you know, they kind of combine to produce a new number, a number baby that Alice and Bob will use for their secret key. So you see here, they both have the same secret key because of the number baby situation, and they can share their cat pictures and so forth. The way that Alice and Bob generate this number baby, the mathematical name for this problem, is called prime factorization. So it is very easy for Alice's computer and Bob's computer to have their number baby, to generate their secret key, but it is very hard for Mala to come across the same secret key if she doesn't know those two private numbers. So she can know the public numbers, she can find those out, but because she doesn't have these private numbers, she cannot essentially recreate Alice and Bob's key. This is the state we're in now. Our information is protected through strong encryption, through strong mathematics, as it flows out across the internet. This is the reason we can send money, we can send, you know, we can send messages, we can send our passwords, everything, because we are protected through strong maths. However, something new has come onto the scene, and that something is quantum computing. Google, for example, has developed a quantum computer called Sycamore, which can do in 3 minutes and 20 seconds what a traditional computer, what would take a traditional computer 10,000 years. So Google claims that this represents an industry milestone called quantum supremacy, where quantum computers can do things in a short amount of time that would take a traditional computer a very long time. So the kind of the potential of this technology is so great that all the big guys are racing to develop the technology. So IBM, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, you know, big countries like the US and China and things like that, because the potential is so great. So the things that we would use quantum computers for are the very hard problems that traditional computers can't help us with. So this is like developing new fuels, new drugs, you know, for example, you know, folding complex proteins and things like that, and modeling of complex markets, so to work out how to get more money and things like that. So this is where we're at with quantum computing. So a very strange, mysterious force that offers us a new universe of how to do things. Extremely powerful technology. But again, how does it work? So traditional computers, the pieces of information that they work with, little bits as they're called, you can think of them like zero and one, night and day, on and off. So very simple states of information. So as I said, these are called bits. Quantum computers use qubits, so quantum bits, and they can be in a variety of different states at the same time. So for example, you're probably familiar with Schrodinger's box, you know, how the cat in the box can be both somehow dead and alive at the same time. That's kind of how it works with quantum computers. So the little pieces of information can be in different states at the same time. This is incredibly useful when we're solving these complicated problems because, so for example, you can think of like a labyrinth. A quantum computer would be able to solve the labyrinth by being all of the different paths in the labyrinth at the same time. So what scientists can do is kind of nudge the qubits to fall into the correct answer to the maze. A traditional computer, on the other hand, would have to, you know, manually, you know, kind of walk through the maze like we would if we were doing it. That's essentially how a very high-level overview of how quantum computers work. But what does this mean for your best friend, encryption? Unfortunately, it's not great news. So we talked about this number baby problem, which is very hard for traditional computers to reverse. Unfortunately, it's exactly the type of problem that quantum computers are very good at doing. There's an algorithm called Shor's algorithm, which is basically a recipe for disaster. It's essentially, it was developed in the 80s, and it is proven or widely recognized to be able to crack that secret key and essentially get the number there. So there was no computer powerful enough to run that algorithm, but now with the coming of quantum computers, it is possible to run that. So you can see we're back with Alice and Bob, but now Mala has a quantum computer. So Alice and Bob have followed that same path we talked about before in terms of scrambling their information, but now because Mala has a quantum computer, she can see the information as it flows across the internet. Experts think that a group with a quantum computer could essentially see everything as it flows across the internet. Transactions, messages, passwords, you know. It's essentially revealing the entire, all the data on the internet. The US government, for example, thinks that a group with a quantum computer could achieve unprecedented global control. So control that no one's ever seen before because of their ability essentially to see all of the information on the internet. So it's a very scary quote in a very serious situation. But fortunately, the outlines of the solution are coming into place. A US entity called the National Institute of Standards and Technology is developing a standard for post-quantum cryptography. So this means they're asking for new ciphers, new change machines that will be able to stand up to the power of quantum computing. That standard is due for release in 2024. So as I said, the outlines of the solution are coming together. We should also note that quantum computers are very fragile. So they're very powerful, but they're very fragile. So they're very sensitive to fluctuations in temperature and heat, magnetic fields, electrical fields, and so forth. So they need a huge amount of surrounding insulation from the environment. Shor's algorithm, that recipe for disaster that we talked about earlier, experts think that we need around 6,000 qubits to run that algorithm. Google's Sycamore computer, quantum computer, the most powerful in existence currently, only has around 53 qubits. So we're not yet at the point at which quantum computers can reveal everything, but we are, given the incentives, we will approach that point quite fast. So we've talked about how encryption is your best friend because it protects your information, it tells you who's trustworthy on the internet through the magic of strong mathematics. We've talked about the coming of quantum computing, this weird and mysterious new force that promises to break this encryption and kill your best friend, essentially. So your best friend will not survive, the quantum computer wins. We've also talked about how groups of scientists are rushing to solve this problem, to make sure the older traditional methods of security are updated in the face of quantum computing. So that is where I'll leave you today. Secure in the knowledge that your data is protected currently, but faced with the possibility and potential of a weirder, more powerful, yet more uncertain world to come. Thank you.